Can start. Okay, so again, hi everyone, and welcome to the Foreman community demo. I'm Nofar, I'm a Foreman developer, and I'll be your host for today's demo. Today we have some updates to share with you about our last release and some new things we've been working on. But before we get started, this demo is all about showing you the latest updates and answering any questions you might have. So we want to hear from you. To make this as interactive as possible, feel free to ask questions and share your thoughts with us. You can do this in two ways, by passing your questions and comments on IRC to the Foreman, or by using the YouTube live chat feature. We'll be monitoring both channels throughout the demo, so don't hesitate to speak up. We're here to help and make this demo as valuable for you as possible. Hey, let's have a quick look at the agenda for today's demo. We have 6 topics total. We have 2 announcements, one for the Foreman 3.6 release and the Foreman birthday event. Then we have 4 demos, one for Catello, one for Foreman Ansible, and 2 more Foreman demos. So without further ado, let's get started. Just check the connection. Looks great. Okay. Okay, so first announcement for today is that Foreman 3.6 has been officially released and is now generally available. We would like to thank all the contributors and participants who have helped make this release possible. So compared to the last release candidate, the changes are relatively minor with just a few bug fixes. However, we are happy to announce that the Smart Proxy Ansible plugin now works properly with Debian, on Debian. And you can check out the link to the community post for more details about the release. Yeah, okay, Jeremy, maybe you can tell us about the Catello release before your demo. That's great. Yeah, I guess we can move on to our second announcement, which is the upcoming Foreman birthday event, which will be on July 27th, 2023. Sorry, I'm just checking to see everything works and losing focus. Okay, so this event will be hosted by Derek. So thank you, Derek, and supported by our colleagues from Netways, Ethics, and of course, Foreman. The event will be online. It will be streamed live on YouTube, following the format of the 2021 event. And also, we do hope to return to a face-to-face event in the future, but this year we'll keep it online. So what should we expect in this event? The event will consist of between 5 to 6 30-minute talks. We're looking for a wide variety of talks related to Foreman, including new plugins, case studies, Foreman itself, and other related topics. All talks will be pre-recorded, and attendees will have the opportunity to ask questions live after the talk. In addition to the talks, we are planning a social event and chat during the breaks. And there's also a link to the post to the recap of the last event for those who want to know more about it. I have to say that I checked the link and the YouTube video from last previous years, 2021, and it looks so fun and I really can looking forward to it. So we encourage anyone interested in giving a talk to get in touch with Derek. And we also ask you in the community to save the date and spread the word, promising to update the thread with news as their plans move forward. Yeah, so we can move on to the first demo for today, which will be presented by Jeremy from Catello. So Jeremy, whenever you're ready.
All right, thanks, Nofar. Let me share my screen here. Oh yeah, and I was saying before the Catella 4.8 release candidate 1 is now ready for testing too. I just saw the announcement this morning. Catella 4.8 is the Catella version that goes with Foreman 3.6. So if you want to test them together, please feel free. But what I'm talking about this morning is going to be in Catella 4.9. And that is some improvements we've made to the Content View Details page repositories tab. So this is what you would see up until now. It's the default view is all repositories here. So you can see repositories that are added to your content view and repositories that are not added. And it could be a little bit confusing because if you don't know to look at this column, you would sort of assume that all three of these repositories are part of your content view here, when that's not actually the case. So in the new version of Catella, this view is going to default to added. So when you first arrive on the page, you will only see the repositories that are actually added to the content view. So here I just see the one that I've added and I don't see the other two. And of course, as always, you can change the view if you want to all or added or not added. And then as part of this, we've also added a couple of empty states, we call them. So if you don't have any repositories in your content view, you will see this. And there's a very easy button you can click here to show the repositories that are available to add, and then you can go add them as normal. And then the second empty state we've added is if you don't have any repositories at all in your organization, why is it not working? Oh. That's why. So if you don't have any repositories at all in your organization, you'll see this empty state. So you know, there's still something you can do about it. You can either go enable some Red Hat repositories or you can create a custom product. And after you do either one of those things, then the repositories will appear here for you to add. So there's some convenient links so you can go do that. And there's also a documentation link. I think this is the first documentation link we've added to Catella. And right now in development, I have to change the Foreman version, but once Catella is released, you won't have that issue. So you can go read about adding products and repositories right from that screen there. So those are the changes we've made. As always, I'm available here or online for any questions. Thanks.
Great, thanks, Jeremy. Share my screen again. Yeah, let's see if we have any questions before moving on. Okay, I guess we're clear. Okay, just a sec, let me see. Okay, everything is good. And the next topic will be presented by me, and show correct exit status Ansible jobs on multiple hosts. So actually I need to share another tab. Let's see if it works. Okay. Okay, great. So this new fix is when you execute an Ansible job, any Ansible job, it doesn't have to be just Ansible alls, also any playbook, but on multiple hosts. So I have an example here. Okay. So this job is just the basic on all Ansible alls on two hosts, where you can see one of them failed. And the fix is that previously they were both shown as failed. And in this fix, we separate between the results of every host. And now you can see the successful host marked as success and the failed one as failure. Let me open these two tabs. Actually, you can change the tabs. I'm sharing. Okay. Yep. Okay. Nope. Reminds me of the poll we had about the menu. Yeah, it is too long. I wonder why it's not closing. Okay. Okay, great. So this is the first job execution result, and you can see exit status 0, meaning that the job runs successfully with no failures. This is the first host, the green one, of course. And the second one, see here. Yeah, Mark just failed because I gave him a role that should always fail. Exit status here is 2, and you can see, of course, there's an error. So this is the new fix. It's a relatively small one, but very important. Yeah, and we want to separate between the hosts. So even if the job execution failed, because even just one host was failing the whole job, considered as failure, we wanted to fix that because it was available for our users to see the actual results for each host. Okay, so I don't see any questions, but feel free to reach out to me about this if you encounter any issues or anything. I'm here for you. And yeah, can move to our next presentation. Okay, so host searching by the Pixie loader by Marek. So Marek, whenever you're ready.
Thank you. So after a while, I have a very small contribution, but I wanted to show you that, you know, our hosts can have a Pixie loader set in this operating system tab. We have the Pixie loader selector in here. It can be set to none or some other values. The problem was that it wasn't possible to search hosts by that. So now it is actually possible. So you can type pixie loader equals to, and then you have nice auto suggestion of the possible values. So you can see we have 44 hosts on this page. If I search by pixie BIOS, we got 40. So you can filter by that now easily. Now, in the host form, I showed that there is none value, and the searching for some technical reasons is a bit complicated to do for none value. So don't be surprised, you can't do something like this, pixie loader equals none. But if you're searching for empty values, our scoped search syntax actually allows to do this. So you say null pixie loader, and that will give you all the hosts without any pixie loader set. So none is not a textual value you can search by, but none basically means there's no value. So you need to use this search syntax. Okay, that's pretty much it. I just want to use this opportunity to say, if there is something, some attribute or something that you can't search by, let us know, either on this course or open an issue. It's usually very simple to add a new search definition. And that's it for me.
Great, thank you, Mark. So our next topic, selectable columns, CSV export by Oleh. So Oleh, yeah.
Thank you. Let me just quickly show my screen. And it should be visible. Okay, thank you, and hello, everyone. Today I'm going to show you a change that we've made to export button on the hosts page. And just to make sure, I'm talking about this particular button. This currently is my Foreman 3.5 setup, and I'm going to show you how it works now or how it worked before. So as you can see, I've got some columns here, modified by manage columns. I've got here, for example, lifecycle environment as an additional column, and I want to export all of these hosts to a CSV report. So let's do that, and I'm going to show you how it looks today. I will use Visual Code just to get better visibility on that. As you can see, I've got here some subset of columns that I can observe on the page itself. As you can see, again, I have here lifecycle environment and owner, but I cannot observe them in the CSV export. As you can see, they're just name, operating system, model, host group, and last report. And that's these are default values that were present there for quite a while. But since we've added a new feature, which is selectable columns, we've noticed that it would be quite a nice feature to have in the CSV report those columns as well. And this feature is available starting Foreman 3.6. And I'm going to demonstrate it on my development environment, but that's just Foreman 3.6 with some new other fixes. But anyway, let's just try to select all of our columns. And let's try to export them into CSV report. As you may see, there are quite a lot of columns selected, but that's what we wanted. And the new report will look like this. As you may see, there is all the information that is available on the host's index page itself. So you can export everything that you've selected. Just as a reminder, this feature is available starting from Foreman 3.6, and that's pretty much it. Thank you.
Great. Thanks, Oleh. I don't see any questions yet. Yeah, we're all clear. Let me share my screen again. Even though it wasn't on the topic list, we still have one more topic to share. Just a sec. Make sure, yeah. Okay, so our last topic for today, again, it wasn't on the list, just edit it. It's about a post that Evgeny wrote this month about using personal access tokens with Ansible. Actually, let me share the actual post. Of course, I will add it later to the list, so you can also have the link to yourself. And okay, I guess now you can see. Okay, yeah, so this post, as I mentioned by Evgeny, is about using Ansible to manage Foreman with Foreman Ansible models. Again, let me start over. So when using Ansible to manage Foreman with Foreman Ansible models, authentication requires a username and password. However, if external authentication methods like LDAP or Kerberos are used and the user doesn't have a password in Foreman, so providing the LDAP password to Ansible could compromise security. Foreman addresses this by supporting personal access tokens, so PATs, since version 1.17. And PATs can be used instead of passwords to authenticate APIs requests and are stored and validated by Foreman. So making them compatible with any authentication method. And basically in the blog post, you can really go through the steps on how to achieve that. You have screenshots for everything, very easy. I think like 4 steps, even less. And here, hope you can see clearly, you have an example of how you can use, let me actually zoom in a little bit. How you can use that password in an Ansible playbook. So you can see it's the same token here under the password. I guess that's it. Thanks a lot to Evgeny for taking the time and creating this post. And I hope you'll benefit from it. And also post comments here in the end if you want to ask something or discuss anything. That's it, basically. So if you have any questions, now's the time. Okay, I guess no more questions, because let me do a final check. Yeah, everything looks clear. Okay, so if there aren't any more questions, that concludes our demo for today. Next demo is on April 13. And we hope you enjoyed our presentation for today and seeing what's new with Foreman. And we look forward to seeing you next time.